I am Anders Hagstrom with the Daily Caller, and with me today I have the pleasure of introducing Michael Reagan. He is the son of President Ronald Reagan. You're a member, obviously, of the Reagan Legacy Foundation, and we are just a day or two away from Memorial Day. It's on everybody's minds right now, even amid coronavirus, where Americans are ready to commemorate the loss of our soldiers, the sacrifice of our soldiers. And the Reagan Legacy Foundation, you guys are doing something specifically for World War II veterans. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I have a foundation, Reagan Legacy Foundation, and a few years ago, I was invited to raise the flag at the American Cemetery at Normandy, which was really cool. And I was playing golf with a young man, 28 years old, managed a store over by where I live, and talking about what you're talking about in golf courses. And I told him, I said, I'm headed to Normandy tomorrow, and I'm going to raise the flag at the American Cemetery. And he looked at me and said, well, why is there an American Cemetery at Normandy? 28 years old, had no idea why we had an American Cemetery at Normandy. So you can imagine what the rest of the golf game was like. And I ultimately said to him, did you think D-Day was in your report when your report card came home from school? And so I was in Normandy, raised the flag, went to St. Mary Glees, Normandy, France, first town freed by America, D-Day morning, 4 a.m. in the morning, and met the people there, the most wonderful people, went to the Airborne Museum, spoke with the people there, and said, what can I do? My father was the first president to ever speak on D-Day, the 40th anniversary of D-Day, there in St. Mary Glees at Normandy. And so we decided a couple of years ago that one of the things we could do was start a brick project to start remembering these World War II vets, these first responders, if you will, of World War II, to remember them and start bricking in the walkways through the Airborne Museum with the names of those who served in the European theater during World War II. And we've been doing this now for the last couple of years. We have 300 bricks right now ready to go in, but of course the virus has slowed that up. But people can go online to walkwaytovictory.com, purchase a brick, and that brick will be put, you know, there at St. Mary Glees at the Airborne Museum.
Mm-hmm. And you, of course, mentioned the 28-year-old who clearly had no idea what Normandy was. Maybe our education system failed him a little bit there. So obviously, memory of this event seems to be fading from the American consciousness. Every year, we're losing more and more World War II vets. My grandfather, Harold Zeman, he was a World War II vet, fought in Germany, and he died just last spring. Could you tell us a little bit, like, what can Americans do to preserve this legacy?
I mean, you know, so we have Memorial Day, we have Veterans Day, but every day we need to thank them and remember them for what they did and what they incurred when they saved the world back in the 1940s, and say thank you to them. You know, it's really amazing when you have this brick, and a lot of people don't have the names of a loved one who served in the European theater. They can send a check to the Reagan Legacy Foundation, ReaganLegacyFoundation.org. And what we'll do is we will find the name of somebody who served, and we'll put that brick in the ground, but you will have all the information on that person. You will have a connection with a person who served in World War II through Reagan Legacy Foundation because of that brick. You'll be able to say, hey, I did that. But to go there and see these young kids who are now in their late 80s and 90s and see a brick with their name in it, I mean, they literally are brought to tears that somebody is still remembering them. And think about it. You have, 16 million kids served in that war? You now have a little over 300,000 are left, and they're dying every single year. And if you want to give your child a great history lesson, take them to Normandy, France, visit St. Mary Glees, visit Omaha Beach, visit all the beaches, and really fill them and let them see what it was those responders went through to allow us to have these children and for them to be free.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned that you could purchase these bricks. Where are those funds going?
The funds, first of all, they go to, of course, to make the brick and send the brick to St. Mary Glees and put it in the ground. But any funds that are left over stay with the Reagan Legacy Foundation, and they're moved over to our financial side that deals with scholarships for those kids who serve on board the USS Ronald Reagan. We started a process with them years ago where we provide $1,000 scholarships to those who serve on the ship. We provide $2,000 scholarships if you're a family member with a loved one who serves on the USS Ronald Reagan. And so any monies that are left on the brick go to that scholarship program to help kids who are serving right now, you know, in the war on terror. Right now, the USS Ronald Reagan is in Tokyo, Japan, keeping an eye on that area of the world. She heads up the 7th Fleet. So not only are you remembering those of the 1940s who saved the world, but you're also helping those who are now doing the same thing.
Mm-hmm. And we talked about a little bit about this before the show, but obviously Americans are in the midst of coronavirus right now, and various states are in lockdown. What do you think your father would be saying to Americans right now during this crisis, were he still alive?
You know, he would be bringing a calm to it. My father never panicked. With my father, the glass was always half full. It was never half empty. On his gravesite, if you ever visit the Ronald Reagan Library and see his gravesite, and read what's above it. In all men, there is good. And my father always looked for the good. And today in America, that's what we need to be doing. We need to start looking for the good in America and the good in those people who live here in America. And I think that would make us all feel better. Quit pointing fingers and instead look for the good.
Mm-hmm. And I don't want to get too political here necessarily, but do you think from our leaders, both Democrat and Republican right now, do you think they have really the interests of the American people front and center in their priorities, or do you think they're sort of like they're focusing too much on petty squabbles?
They're focusing too much on squabbles, pointing fingers, if you will. You know, it'd be time to like grow up. There's a lot of people out here. There's 35, 36 million people without a job. Their jobs to their families is a priority, is essential. And that is sad to see in America. You know, when I was younger, I dove under a desk, you know, because of nuclear war. But in this day and age, they're telling you not to shake hands with a friend or telling a child not to play with their five-year-old buddy or their six-year-old buddy.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very tough time. And I think the government too often doesn't think about the end game. They only think about the game that's going on.
Mm-hmm. And what has your personal experience been? And obviously you mentioned that you live in LA, California, which is one of the most stringently locked down states and cities in the country right now. What has your experience been?
Well, the experience is that I live in L.A. where I can walk on the beach, run on the beach. I can surf at the beach, but I can't sit on the beach. And you're sitting there saying, where are the stats on there? Where is the scientific evidence that I can't sit on a beach? Where is that? I don't know where it is. I can't find it. And I've said that my worst fear is, and I think it's going to happen, that ultimately there's going to be more businesses that are going to die than people. And that is just, that's horrific what's happening to families. You know, you have a situation where you have a bottom up. Those of us at the top, okay, I'm okay. My family's okay. But those at the bottom, those who served us, those who wait tables, those that open stores, you know, you have the big box store that's out there doing well, but the mom and pop that own the Ace Hardware down the street are going bankrupt and losing their homes and losing their livelihoods. And that is what's sad. And when you have conferences in Los Angeles, for example, with our mayor, you know, who tells you what the lockdown's gonna be like till July 4th, and basically ends the press conference with letting you know what the suicide hotline number is, you've got issues. I mean, when you're dealing with that and you see people are seriously considering suicide and they know that, you know, the programs they're putting in place could cause this. You've got to make it work. And what's interesting, my dad, I remember my dad saying in his inaugural address. Why are we great? Why do we accomplish things? Because we're Americans. And right now, I don't think we're allowed or being allowed to be Americans.
Mm-hmm. What do you think President Reagan would have said about President Trump's handling of this? Do you think he would have generally agreed with what Trump is doing or no?
He never spoke ill of another Republican, the 11th commandment. You know, he never spoke ill of a Democrat president. You know, he served his term. He served his 8 years and he walked away. It's now somebody else's turn. And that's the way it really should be. Get, you know, your term's over. Let this president now handle it. And unfortunately, we're not doing that today. We're again, we're not respecting the office the way we should.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you've certainly seen like early on, President Trump's polling was pretty poor on this, and then it's been recovering ever since. But Americans don't seem to like either Republicans or Democrats' response to this very much. I don't think members of either party are very enthusiastic about what their politicians are doing. What do you think that really means when we're going into November, when we're going to see this election and voters don't necessarily like what Nancy Pelosi has done and Republican voters don't necessarily love what President Trump has done? What do you think that means for this election?
It depends where we are, you know, in November. You know, a couple of weeks out, if you will. It depends what's going on. If people are back to work, that's one thing. If they're not back to work, that's another. I said in an interview about a month ago, somebody asked me, when do you think the lockdown's going to end? I said, the government's not going to tell you when it's going to end. The people are going to tell you when it's going to end. And you see people out there now. But I look at this, and what's really scary is a friend of mine owns a hair salon. And he's out of business, basically. And I said, why aren't the people in hair salons up in arms? He said, because they'll pull our license. And I'm thinking to myself, my God, didn't I live through this in the 1940s? And what did we fight for? What are those guys that we're honoring this weekend fight for? They fought for our freedoms. And when you're being told that your license will be pulled away if you open your business, that's just, to me, so outrageous. Let us be Americans. If I want to sit on the beach, let me sit on the beach. Let me do that. If I want to go to a restaurant, let me go to a restaurant. But what's happening today is that you're having neighbors turn in neighbors. That happened in France when the French used to tell, you know, on their neighbors to the Gestapo. And that's what they did in the Second World War. That's what the Second World War was all about. And now we're at a point where the virus is being used to pit neighbor against neighbor, politician against politician, and somebody who's sitting in their home, you know, pitting them against their business. Do I stay in the home or do I open my business and take a shot at it to feed my family, my children, and my loved ones? I mean, it depends what's going on in November. And I will tell you, I think if we're not free by election time, all bets are off. I think that, in fact, Trump ends up, you know, probably winning at that point. I don't think they can blame Trump for this at all, even though they're trying to point fingers. The culprit in this is China. This is the culprit. These are the bad guys. You know, not Americans, the bad guys. 2020 hindsight, you know, is always there. But the Chinese are the ones that brought it to us.
Mm-hmm. And what do you think? Obviously, President Trump has had some things to say about punishing China, but he hasn't really gone. He said that if it's knowingly confirmed that they contributed to the spread of the virus, then they should face some consequences. It pretty much has been confirmed that they did knowingly do that, but he's been hesitant to talk about any reparations or something along those lines. Do you think something like Senator Josh Hawley is a Republican from Missouri? He introduced legislation that would allow Americans to directly sue China. Do you think that that's something that should be pursued?
I mean, yeah, I mean, I would support the legislation to sue China. Whether you'll ever get the money is something else, or when you'll get the money is something else. But you can't ask the president, what are you going to do? I remember because I was with my dad, you know, when he sent the planes into Tripoli back in the 80s, he didn't tell anybody. He didn't call Tripoli. He didn't do a press conference and say, hey, we're coming over. When he went into Grenada, he didn't have a press conference and say, hey, we're thinking about going into Grenada. Just all of a sudden, we were in Grenada or we were in Tripoli. That's what the president needs to do. He doesn't need to be, you know, telling people what he might do. He just needs to do it. And I think that has a more of a that's more uplifting to Americans, if you will. And the point gets more across. Remember, he went into Tripoli overnight with a couple of F-14s, and Gaddafi stayed quiet for over 20 years.
Certainly a poignant reminder right now, this Memorial Day. Could you run us through one more time of all the information for the BRICS and how we can get access to that?
You can go to walkwaytovictory.com, order a brick to $250 for a brick or $500 for a larger brick. RegularLegacyFoundation.org, if you'd like to find out where you can mail a check and put in the memo, just put brick project. We'll get the name and get the brick and send you all the information. So you'll have someone that you can relate to that's got, has a brick in the ground. So walkwaytovictory.com, do that and help us remember those who fought in World War II, in the European theater, that literally saved the world.
Mm-hmm. All right, Michael Reagan, thank you so much for coming on. We appreciate it.
Thank you.